Hello. In this video, we will cover post-hoc testing. This belongs together with the ANOVA test we covered in the last video. So if you are not sure you remember all the details about how to conduct an ANOVA analysis, I would ask you to go back and re-watch the last video. So here we have a typical example of an ANOVA setting. In this experiment, a group of researchers measured the concentration of strontium in 5 bodies of water. It's called Beaver Lake, Grayson's Pond, Angler's Cove, Apple Tree Lake, and Rock River. And the question that we would like to answer is whether these 5 bodies of water have significantly different concentrations of strontium, and which have higher concentration than others. You can see that in each of the bodies of waters, 6 measurements were taken. And you can also see the averages down here. From the averages, it's clear that Rock River, on average, appears to have the highest concentration and Grayson Pond the lowest concentration. But as you will remember last week, if we're interested in testing for the differences between these different bodies of waters, we cannot simply resort to pairwise testing due to the multiple comparisons problem. So instead, we came up with an ANOVA procedure, which tests a global hypothesis that all of the concentrations in all of the 5 ponds are equal, versus the alternative hypothesis that they are not, that there's at least one concentration that is significantly different from the others. The results of such an ANOVA analysis are often summarized in such an ANOVA table, where we list the different sources of variability, their respective degrees of freedom, their sum of squares, and the mean squared error. These we can use to compute the so-called F-statistic. The F-statistic was the mean square between groups divided by the mean square within groups, and relates the variability that the means between different groups have to the variability that is within each group, capturing also our intuition about how we judge different situations in this setting. In this case, the F-statistic is 56.2, which is fairly large. With this, we are able to do a statistical test because we know, under the assumption that the null hypothesis is true, we know the distribution of the F-statistic. It follows a so-called F-distribution. And you can use a computer or a table to look up that with an F-statistic of 56.2, with 4 and 25 degrees of freedom, you will obtain a p-value that is smaller than 10 to the minus 11, and thus we reject the null hypothesis. So what we know now is that there is some difference between the different ponds, but we don't know which of the pairs of ponds are actually different. So if we summarize our ANOVA analysis, we would write something. We found a significant difference in the mean strontium concentration of the 5 lakes. We state the p-value, the F-statistic, our total sample size, and the test that we used. All of these, just to remind you, are essential information that you need to give in each summary sentence that you write for a statistical analysis. Of course, in science, we're often interested in to find out which of the groups is actually different from the others. So here we would like to know which of the lakes differs. And for that, we use a procedure called post-hoc testing. We will cover 2 different versions of this, the very basic, so-called Bonferroni correction, and then the more useful, practically useful, Tukey's honestly significant differences. How does the Bonferroni correction work? You can make a simple observation. The probability to conduct at least one error in m tests is smaller than the probability of the sum conducting an error in any of the tests. So to correct for the inflated probability of conducting multiple tests, we simply divide our threshold from which we claim significant difference by the total number of tests being conducted. So instead of a alpha value of alpha, we use an adjusted alpha tilde, where alpha is divided by m, the number of tests. So if in total we conduct 10 tests, and our alpha value from which we judge a difference to be significant is 0.05, then we divide 0.05 by 10 and obtain 0.005 and use this as a new threshold for our p-value so that we claim that the difference is significant. This quantity here, probability to conduct at least one error in all the m tests, is also called the experiment-wise error rate. And this is what we want to control in this post-hoc testing scenario. The advantage of the Bonferroni method is that it's extremely simple and very easy to do. The problem with it is that it's quite conservative, which means that you often will conduct type 2 errors using this procedure. So you have reduced power compared to other methods. So this is again reiterating the example that I gave on the last slide. So if you have 5 groups, you have 10 comparisons, so you have to adjust your alpha value from 0.05 by dividing by 10 to 0.005 to control your experiment-wise error rate to be actually below 0.05. So now we would like to have a better alternative. And a better alternative is Tukey's test. It's also sometimes called honestly significant differences, or HSD. How does this work? In this case, you start by first rank ordering the means. So if you remember the slide from the beginning, the fifth lake, or the fifth river, I think, has the highest mean until the second lake, which had the smallest. And we just order them. Then we tabulate the pairwise differences of the means. And we start with the largest difference, so the difference between the fifth and the second. So first we compare the fifth with the second lake. This is the largest difference. Then we compare it with the second smallest, and so on and so forth. Then we continue with the second largest value, and we compare these to the smallest, and to the second smallest, and so on. And we do that until all the comparisons have been done. Then we have a large table, and I will show you an example on the next slide. So here I continue to explain the procedure. So for each of these tests, our null hypothesis is that the two means are equal. If we reject this null hypothesis, we simply go to the next test, to the next pairwise comparison that we need to do according to our sorted table. If we retain the null hypothesis, so if you cannot reject the null hypothesis that these two means are equal, then we draw a line connecting the means A and B that we compared, and we skip all means enclosed by that line. I will show you what that means in the practical example. Similar to the t-test, we calculate the standard error as a mean square within divided by the number of samples. We also calculate a statistic, the difference in mean divided by the standard error, but in this case it's called Q. This distribution that Q follows if the null hypothesis is true is called studentized range distribution. And this allows us, again, to find a threshold when we reject the null hypothesis. The fact that this distribution is a bit different from a standard t-test accounts for the fact that we do this in this multiple comparison framework, or in this post-hoc testing framework of ANOVA. Okay, here's finally the promised example. So We said the fifth lake has the highest concentration of strontium compared with the second one. The difference, in fact, is 26.2. When we compute the standard error, it's this, and the Q statistic is this. Our threshold for rejecting the null hypothesis at an alpha level of 0.05 is 4.2. So Q is clearly larger than that. So that means that if we convert Q to a p-value, we would obtain a p-value that is much smaller than 0.05. Because the experimentally observed Q is so large that under the assumptions that the two means are equal, it's very unlikely to find Q values that are as or more extreme in magnitude than the one we observed in the data. So the conclusion is we reject the null hypothesis that the mean of group 5 and of group 2 are equal. Then we compare the largest mean to the group with the next larger mean from the smallest one. Here the difference is smaller, of course. The Q statistic is smaller, but it's still larger than the threshold value. So we also reject the null hypothesis that means 5 and means 1 are equal. And we continue to do so for all of them. So we conclude the group, the mean of group 5 is significantly different from all other means. Now we go to the next smaller group, which is group 3. We compare group 3 to the smallest group, which is group 2, and we find the Q statistic is 9.4, which is still larger than our threshold value. So we also reject the null hypothesis here. Now, when we do the next comparison, testing group 3 versus group 1, so this comparison here, we find that now our Q value is actually smaller than the threshold value. So we don't reject the null hypothesis that these two means are different. Instead, we retain it. So according to the procedure of our test, we then connect these two group means here, and we skip all the tests in between. That means specifically that we don't compare group 3 to group 4, because we have already concluded that we have not enough power to test the much larger difference and find a significant difference there. According to that logic, if we found now a significant difference between group 3 and group 4, this would have to be a false positive. So 3 versus 4, we don't test. Then we go to group 4. We do the test to compare to group 2. And we find that we can reject the null hypothesis here. But we don't compare group 4 to group 1, because this is still encompassed by our line here. And it's a comparison that we don't do, because we already know that it should be negative. And finally, we compare group 1 to group 2. So our overall conclusion is that group 2 has a mean that is significantly lower than the rest. There's a large group of three groups that we cannot differentiate from each other, that for our purposes we have to assume that they have equivalent strontium concentrations. And then group 5 actually has a statistically significantly higher concentration. So we would add to our summary of the ANOVA results from before. The strontium concentration in Rock River was significantly higher, in Grayson's Pond significantly lower than in the other lakes. Tukey's honestly significant different test at an alpha level of 0.05. So with this, you can do effective postdoc testing without inflating your type 1 error rate, retaining much of the power. This procedure, however, can also result in ambiguous results. So it could be that we get the following results. So we cannot say that groups 4 to 2 are different. So these here, we for all of these comparisons, we retain the null hypothesis. And also groups 5 through 4, we retain the null hypothesis. But we find that groups 2 and groups 3 have a significantly different means. So in this case, at least one type 2 error must have occurred. So one occasion where we missed to find a difference where there actually was one. And the only thing that we can conclude in this case is that these two means we cannot reject the null hypothesis, and for these two means we cannot reject the null hypothesis. Thank you for your attention on this short explanation of post-hoc testing.